Welcome to Columbia HPM Presents with Professor Michael Sparer.
Hi, I'm Michael Sparer. I'm a professor in the chair of the Department of Health Policy and Management at the Mailman School of Public Health at Columbia University. And I'm delighted to welcome you to today's webinar entitled Public Health Commissioners and COVID-19 Beyond the Headlines. This event is part of an ongoing series of panels that we've been holding over the last 2-3 months, in which we've invited leaders in a variety of sectors, both the public and private sector in the health and healthcare industry, to talk about and to talk with us about both organizational and policy and political issues implicated by the current pandemic. With me today are three local public health commissioners from here in New York State, and let me introduce them right now. Dr. Sherlita Amler is the Commissioner of Health in Westchester County. Before she became Commissioner in Westchester, she was Commissioner of Health in Putnam County. She is a longtime leader in the public health community here in New York State, and we're delighted to have you.
Thank you.
Dr. Kevin Watkins leads the public health agency in Cattaraugus County, and I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, Dr. Watkins.
Close.
You know, it's a rural county in western New York near the Pennsylvania border. Dr. Watkins is also the president of the New York State Association of County Health Officers. And so we're really pleased to have you with us today.
Thank you.
And then third, you may have noticed on your flyer, it said that Dr. Michael Mendoza from Monroe County would be joining us. But as public health commissioners will say, things come up at the last minute, and an unexpected emergency came up in Monroe County. So Dr. Mendoza had to pull out. But fortunately, really fortunately for us, Dr. Patricia Rupert, the health commissioner in Rockland County, who's also a faculty member here at Columbia and also an alum of our program here at the Mailman School, was able to join us today. So we're really grateful for you, Patty, for joining us and to all three of you for being here today.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Thanks. So before we dive into the COVID-19 pandemic and the impact in your counties and New York State and around the country, I want to take a moment just to give a little bit of context here. Many of our viewers are probably quite familiar with the CDC in Washington, D.C. They've watched Tony Fauci on television recently. Maybe they've even watched Howard Zucker, the Commissioner of Health here in New York State, and they understand that each state has a sort of a health department. But I'm not sure that all of our viewers recognize and understand that there are over 3,000 local health departments in the United States, and that those local health departments are the front lines and are the core of the public health system here in the United States. And they've been at the front line, at the core, not only of the response to the current pandemic, but to all of the public health activities that we engage in as a country more generally. So maybe Dr. Watkins, could you start us off and just talk a little bit about, maybe even before COVID-19 hit, you know, sort of, you know, what the role of the local health department is, a little bit about your own agency in Cattaraugus County, and a little bit of context to sort of let the viewers know about local public health departments, both in New York and around the country.
Well, for New York State, there are about 58 local health departments within New York State, not including New York City. The role basically is to advance community health for a particular community, to provide healthy solutions for a community, to educate the community about health issues, and to protect communities against any kind of health threats. Those are the basic roles of a local health department. I run a very as you say, I'm in a rural community. We have a medium-sized health department that has a home care unit. It has environmental health. It has a laboratory. We have family planning. We have a health education unit and early intervention and child care. Not all health departments have that, but that's my small health department. And basically, this is the structure of most health departments, and we take on a level of work that is really issued by New York State Department of Health.
That's really helpful. So thank you very much. I mean, again, I want to make sure that people know and understand the role of the local health department and how important it is. And a piece of that role, an important piece of that role as well, is to help take the lead on emergency preparedness and disaster response and response to pandemics. And so Dr. Amler or Sherlita, let me turn to you for a moment and ask you to go back to, in a certain sense, I suppose, January and February of 2020, in which you, I'm sure, were beginning to read about the virus starting to rage first in Wuhan and then in Italy and Iran and other parts of the world. But then the virus came to your home, your home steps, your front door. It came to New Rochelle when in late February, I believe the second person confirmed in New York State with COVID-19 was a 50-year-old lawyer from New Rochelle. Maybe tell us a little bit about the preparation you did before you heard about that confirmed case in New Rochelle and sort of how you were preparing and then what you did when you got the news that this case was there.
Well, our introduction to COVID really started in late January, early February, when the CDC started going to 11 airports in the United States and basically quarantining or isolating travelers coming from China, predominantly from Wuhan in that area, who they thought might have been exposed to COVID. So we were advised that as a local health department, it was our responsibility to identify locations where these individuals could be either placed in quarantine or isolation. And how would we as a small, as a municipality, as a county, how would we provide wraparound services? I mean, you can't just put somebody in a hotel room or a location for 14 days and not feed them or provide laundry services, medical care if they need it, transportation. That basically sounds very easy to start with, but then you have to realize if they get sick, you have to go in and be able to test them. Do you know how to do a COVID test? What kind of personal protective equipment do your staff need to wear in order to do that? Where would the lab specimens need to be sent? There was a whole host of issues that we had to develop plans on. And it was lucky for us that we did, because in I think it was the 2nd of March, it was either the 2nd or the 4th of March, at 1 o'clock in the morning, I got a call from New York State Department of Health telling me that we had the first positive case in our area and that it was in New Rochelle and that the state health department would be meeting my staff there at 8 o'clock in the morning and that I needed to have people available. I needed to have cars available. I needed to have personal protective equipment available and that we would be hitting the ground running. Had we not had those weeks before that, where we had actually had two travelers that we had put into quarantine, that we had dealt with and done testing on and wore PPE in order to care for, we would not have been ready to have dealt with that. And so luckily, we were able to meet the needs at that moment. And it all focused around doing the case investigation of that initial person and then starting to identify the contacts and get them tested. And so in the beginning, we were sending teams of nurses with environmental staff acting as drivers, helping them get into their personal protective equipment. And they were going into people's homes who were contacts to the case and doing COVID testing. But then the whole situation rapidly escalated when we started getting hundreds and hundreds of positives a day. At that point, you can't do case investigation. You can't really do contact tracing. And so the system evolved into us just doing contact case notification, telling people that their tests were positive, putting them in isolation, and trying to contain the spread of the virus.
No, and it was interesting because that while you had been preparing, for people traveling to the United States, it turned out this person, this 50-year-old person who was diagnosed had not traveled, as far as we knew, from anywhere. He had attended a funeral or a bat mitzvah at a synagogue, and then lo and behold, contracted it. And then we were sort of off and running, I guess, with what they call community spread at that point. It was gone.
Yeah, he had attended multiple large events in the week preceding the illness. And so certainly there were large numbers of people who had some exposure. But, you know, there's always public transportation. You have to look to see, you know, where this person might have gotten the infection and who they might have given it to. In this instance, certainly think that we were already behind the eight ball when right. we knew about it.
Let me ask, Patty, let me ask you. So you were not that far. Rockland County is not that far from Westchester County. You also, I'm sure, in January and early February had been doing some of the same kind of prep work. Tell me a little about, though, you know, one thing that I've read, and I'm honestly not sure in Rockland how this has played out, but one thing that I've read is that one of the complicating factors more generally is that local public health departments have, in recent years, had budgets cut by state governments, have had staff cutbacks, you know, so I think the infrastructure has been cut back in various ways. Was that an issue for you in Rockland? I mean, were there problems in sort of gearing up, or did you have all the staff and infrastructure that you really needed?
So in Rockland, we had lost approximately 25% of our staff over the preceding years. I'm here now 7 years, and prior to that, there was a large egress of people and a loss of people who had retired, were not replaced. So in these intervening years, I've tried to build up the department as best as we could financially, especially as the county has improved its financial status. And I've had a lot of support from our county executive's office in that regard. Having said that, we're still not deep enough. When we dealt with the measles outbreak a year and a half ago, we found that we were not deep enough, and we tried to use lessons learned in that regard to request help. We probably didn't do it as early as we should have during the measles outbreak, and therefore when this all began and started to hit us here in Rockland, I did request assistance from the State Health Department and from CDC much earlier than I had thought of back with the measles outbreak. Of course, this is a whole different situation than we had with measles, and it's affecting everyone at once, worldwide, obviously, but certainly in our country and our state. So the help, you know, has not been able to be there as we probably all could have needed it, at least for the counties who have been maybe less hit than Westchester was. Westchester was inundated, and I did keep in close contact with my colleague, Dr. Amler, in that regard, and learned, you know, what was they were dealing with over in right across the river, right across the Hudson in Westchester, and tried to offer some help until things started to hit here quite drastically as well. But we all started this, as Dr. Amble mentioned, you know, back in January. I started my incident command system, the meetings we have daily with our team, February 7th. We've been meeting daily since then until this past week. We've gone down to 3 days a week. We've had interdepartmental meetings. So we've tried to utilize other staff within the county, and certainly those within our department whose roles are not usually dealing with a pandemic situation. Everyone really has stepped up very well, who normally would not be in their job description, have assisted us with COVID. So you have to pull from who you can.
Yeah. Kevin, Dr. Watkins, you're, in addition to leading, as I mentioned earlier, you know, the health department that you lead upstate, you're also the president of the Association of County Health Officials. And I assume in that role, I mean, Sherlita talked about the state giving the call and saying we're gonna be there at 8 a.m. Maybe talk a little bit from your perspective, both about relationships with the state health department and the federal agencies, you know, here, sort of what kind of help, what kind of guidance, what kind of advice you were getting, what some of the good things about, positive things about that relationship are, what some of the frustrations might've been, and the role the association played in some of these kinds of discussions?
Well, NHHO represents a collective voice of all 58 local health departments, including, you know, a part of New York City as well. And we're pretty much the NHHO is the vehicle for which we deliver answers from multiple questions that arise from the 58 local health departments. And so we have a really exceptional executive director, Sarah Ravenhall, who would intercede those questions that are coming from our 58 local health departments and would relay those questions with New York State Department of Health. oftentimes when you're in the middle of a pandemic, it is very difficult to get everything or every question you have answered. But we were able to build a relationship with New York State Department of Health. That relationship that was built prior to this pandemic really helped us to get that personal attention that we needed for guidance through this pandemic. Oftentimes, there were a lot of areas in which we really had lots of questions that could not be answered immediately. We would have to, when I say we, I mean the executive officers and would meet with Department of Health late in the evening in order to get these questions answered for our local health departments. And that really was an intricate part of getting through this pandemic itself. NASACHO has really been able to also meet with the governor's office for various questions as well. Sometimes there were times where we could not get answers from the State Department of Health, and we had to reach out to the governor's office for questions and answers, and we were able to get through with that as well. We were able to intercede with Centers for Disease Control when there was a need for big outbreaks in large communities. I believe Dr. Amler's community, Dr. Rupert's community, CDC, was able to lend a helping hand to them as well. So for the feds, we were able to reach out to them in that aspect. Unfortunately, sometimes you couldn't get guidance documents in a timely manner, and sometimes you would just have to act on your own as a local leader of your health district. And so sometimes we just had to take our medical knowledge and work with that in order to lead us through some of the questions that we could not get directly from DOH or from the governor's office.
Thanks. No, that's really helpful. I know one of the issues that all of you have had to deal with, and hospitals have had to deal with, and everybody's had to deal with, and individuals have had to deal with, to tell you the truth, are sort of what you might call the supply chain issues. You know, whether it's hospitals and health departments getting the personal protective equipment they need, whether it's getting access to the tests, you know, the COVID tests. I mean, in the early days, you know, back in you know, late February, early March, there were real shortages of tests. And then, of course, there's ventilator questions. Maybe, Sherlita, talk a little bit about, you know, I know you said you'd been prepared, you were preparing, and you were sort of getting the PPE ready and sort of ramping up a little bit. But the volume of cases that began to emerge, you know, and the volume of people in ICUs and the volume of people in emergency rooms and the demand for tests and the demand for personal protective equipment, and from what I've heard, in effect, the competition for some of that personal protective equipment must have been complicated and difficult to manage. Maybe can you talk a little bit about that set of issues and how, whether you were able to get, and the facilities, the health and the healthcare facilities in your community were able to get sort of the supplies that they needed?
Well, the supplies actually were funneled from the state, well, from the feds to the state, to the local Office of Emergency Services. So our EOC, they took all the requests for PPE from all the different facilities. And then every morning I would meet with them and we would run through the lists of requests and try to prioritize what facilities had the greatest need. But one of the problem we had is that, you know, for a healthcare provider, you really want those people in an N95 mask. And to be in an N95 mask, the person has to be fit tested to that specific mask. So if you no longer have that mask, then technically they're supposed to be fit tested whatever mask you have. What we found was that almost no healthcare providers who worked in facilities other than hospitals were fit tested. And so we as a health department actually set up an area, and we've been doing fit testing for our providers, for our nursing homes, adult facilities, adult care facilities, our OPWDD facilities, for a wide variety of facilities who had individuals that they were responsible for their care, who had COVID, who weren't sick enough to be in a hospital. So they had staff caring for these people and they needed to be in PPEs. So we've been doing their fit testing and helping them get personal protective equipment to keep their staff safe, but not only to keep their staff safe, keep their staff from getting ill and spreading it to others. So that was a very involved, took a lot of people, a lot of cooperation across the county to make that happen. And so we talk about what local health departments normally do. Well, I can tell you that my health department, my sanitarians are generally not fit testing people. They're generally not PPE experts, but they've done a lot of things lately that they would never have dreamed that they would have done in past, as have other people within county government.
Right. Speaking of your staff, did you have staff that actually ended up testing positive for COVID themselves?
Yes, we have had staff that have tested positive.
I mean, sort of dealing with the morale issues and dealing with the pressures was also quite a challenge for you at that point.
Well, I think it's, you know, people are afraid not so much of getting sick themselves, but of taking the illness home to their families or their parents. And so making sure that we could keep our own staff as safe as possible has been something of a challenge. But I have to say, I think I have an extremely, as I'm sure my colleagues across the state have, extremely dedicated staff. And they've come to work. When the whole rest of the world has kind of took a pause, I think most local health departments have been working 7 days a week, many long hours for the duration of this event.
No, I think it's extraordinarily impressive and important. Patty, let me switch to you here for a moment. Sherlita was talking a little about some of the impacts on hospitals and working with the hospitals. Obviously, at the same time that COVID was happening, there were people waiting for elective surgeries that were being put off. There were arguably, you know, kids that needed vaccinations and moms may be afraid to take them in for their vaccinations. Maybe talk a little bit about how you dealt with some of the other demands, sort of almost non-COVID related demands for health and healthcare during a crisis like this, particularly in the heart of it in sort of March and April.
So early on, many of the physicians' offices were closed, only except for emergencies. And then they began a lot of telehealth services, you know, that they were able to provide. It took a little time to get that off the ground, but I think they did very well in the community for that. As far as elective surgeries, they were also suspended, you know, as you know, that the hospitals needed to expand their ICUs and utilize, you know, a lot of the space in the ORs and the PACUs, you know, for those purposes, for ICUs. As far as immunizations are concerned, you know, we're very worried from the beginning about the impact on immunizations. We just went through the measles outbreak, and again, it's a reminder of the importance of immunization and knowing that people couldn't really go out or the offices weren't there. In fact, even in our own clinics, we had to shut down our immunization clinic for a number of weeks. It's up and running again, and we are now available. But during that time, there were certainly people throughout the community who were not receiving the proper immunizations that they needed. So that's been a concern of ours, you know, going back. As far as the surgeries are concerned, you know, there were those that were suspended because they were elective and only emergent surgeries were being performed. The concern though was that if people did not present, you know, for routine care, for preventative care, that they will, you know, there will be additional issues going forward in the future. We're going to see more of the worsening of chronic diseases, for example. We're going to see someone who's diagnosed maybe with an early cancer diagnosis that had to wait 3 months, 6 months to have, you know, definitive surgery, for example, or other treatments. So those are now picking up again. We were able, though, to continue some of our clinics, you know, some of our family planning clinics, some things that had to be done, sexual health clinic, for example, some of our WIC clinics, though much of that also went to telehealth. And again, we're a snapshot of what is done in the community. So now with everything waking up again, you know, hopefully people do present for the care that they do need.
Right, because I think it's clear, you know, there are real concerns about did people forego care that they needed, and are there going to be ripple effects down the line? You know, one of the sort of most difficult things to watch from the outside during this whole crisis was the impact on nursing home residents and senior citizens more generally. You know, the state is now coming under a little bit of criticism by some, although I'm curious as to your opinion on this, because in late March, I believe it was, the state issued a directive, I believe it was on March 25th, that no nursing home could deny admission or readmission to someone who had been a resident of the nursing home, had been discharged to the hospital, and they had to be allowed back into the nursing home without regard to whether or not they had a diagnosis, either confirmed or suspected, of COVID-19. Critics are suggesting that that's one of the things that led to the explosion, the outbreak in nursing homes and long-term care facilities more generally. I think the governor and state officials are saying they were following CDC guidelines at the time and they were trying to get people out of the hospital because the hospitals were being overwhelmed. From a local perspective, you've all got nursing homes in your community. You're all watching what was going on in the nursing homes. Maybe, I'm not even sure who to, I'll throw this open to whoever wants to take it on. You know, maybe talk a little bit about sort of the impact on the nursing home communities and sort of, you know, whether or not there were either mistakes made or, and it's always easy to be a Monday morning quarterback, and I'm not asking you to be a Monday morning quarterback, but just ask you to think about how we handle, you know, sort of the issues of the aged and facilities like nursing home facilities more generally.
Well, Cattaraugus County has two nursing homes that we run as a county. And although we have seen the impact of this vulnerable population throughout the state, we did not experience that here in Cattaraugus County. We were pretty precautionary up front. We really limit the visitors that were able to come in initially. And we were able to really hold back on individuals who we at one point thought could properly be positive for COVID-19. Now, I know that the state initially required that anyone who was a nursing home resident was allowed to return back to their beds if they had a bed initially at that nursing home. But if we knew that they were positive at that time, we wanted to wait ahead of time. We wanted to wait before we were allowed them back into the nursing home until their test turned negative. Now, I know that that was against original regs, but it did keep the mortality rate way down.
Saved lives. Saved lives, yeah. Was that, what about in Westchester, Sherlita? How did that play out?
Well, I mean, as you know, the local health departments do not regulate nursing homes. And I think that we certainly saw a number of positive COVID cases in our nursing homes. I think the things that we have learned from this is that even if you restrict visitors, people who work in nursing homes tend to not just work in one nursing home. They may work in multiple nursing homes. So from this, the things that I have learned is that it's very important to make sure that all or as many people who work in a nursing home as possible of direct patient care should be fit tested. As I said before, that's very important, that they have the appropriate PPE, that healthcare providers in these facilities, the people have direct patient contact or in N95 masks, and that testing is done on a regular basis on nursing home employees and also on the residents themselves. I think if those things are put in place, I think going forward, we will not have this problem to the degree that we have had.
Yeah. Patty, do you have thoughts on this?
So as Sherlita had mentioned, you know, though we don't regulate the nursing homes, we certainly as the local health department support them as best we can. So we followed very closely anyone who worked in a nursing home, who was in a nursing home, who we knew were positive or had been positive. We followed any high risk patients. We also provided as best we could PPE that they would need, and we had EMS assist in their fit testing. So again, lessons learned, but we have supported as we always have.
Yeah. let me shift gears a little bit. I was reading, Kevin, I was reading a little about Cattaraugus County and COVID, doing a little bit of homework for our talk this afternoon. And I learned, which I didn't know, that there was a relatively large Amish community in Cattaraugus, as well as a Seneca Native American community. But starting with the Amish, there was a quote from, you know, a leader or one Amish, a member of that community, who was actually being a bit resistant to the idea of physically distancing and saying, you know, that they didn't want to do it. And it actually also reminded me of similar incidents that I had read about with some Orthodox Jewish communities and with some Orthodox Christian communities in terms of sort of communities sort of, you know, raising sort of religious objections to following sort of public health mandates. And I was wondering, wearing your hat as sort of a public health leader, if you could talk about how you deal with and how you dealt with sort of the, you know, the balancing act of trying to respect the views of a religious community, but when the views of those religious community, whether it's, you know, perhaps an Amish group in Cattaraugus County, or perhaps, you know, an Orthodox group in Brooklyn, or, you know, Rockland or Westchester, how you deal with that, and whether or not that proved to be much of an obstacle or a problem, or was sort of overblown as an issue.
Well, it does.
Go ahead, Kevin. What are your thoughts? Since I mentioned the Amish, and then we can. Yeah.
Okay. Well, it does present a problem initially, or it did present a problem initially, as we are setting guidelines for the entire community. You see a certain sector of your community still doing their normal daily tasks. In large gatherings, still going to school, still holding weddings, and everyone else is not allowed to do that, you'll get resentment by the community to say, look, health department, you know, get on your job and make sure that this, that these normal things that are being conducted by this group is stopped immediately. We've had several instances where we had to go out to the Amish community. We had to sit down and we explain the executive orders that were issued about mass gatherings, about cancellation of schools, about cancellation of weddings. And although initially they were resistant, we were able to work with our local sheriff's department, who, when reported that there were still mass gatherings, they would go out and break up those gatherings. When there were weddings, they would break up the weddings. And if we learned that there was school being conducted at one of the schoolhouses, we had our sheriff deputies to go out and actually stop classes. And the Amish community was very receptive. They did not resist to the sheriff deputies coming out and stopping these events. And so because of that, there was really no hard feelings, although we do know that they are a religious organization that do feel that, you know, God will care for them no matter what virus is out there. Now, I know you mentioned the Seneca Nation of Indians, and I'm not sure if you wanted me to discuss that now. In my brief, but yes, we do have a territory where there is a sector of American Indians here, and although they did comply with the executive orders, it was unfortunate that they were one of our groups that had to deal with a large mortality in our county. Although we only had 4 deaths that were recorded in our county, 3 of those deaths were from Seneca Nation of Indian, and that was quite unfortunate. You know, with COVID-19, oftentimes we talk about those individuals that are most vulnerable. Their vulnerability basically was due to having underlying health conditions, diabetes, hypertension, cardiac disease, respiratory disease, those who might have renal disease or immunocompromise. We found that when you had individuals who were dealing with these types of underlying chronic diseases, and they contracted COVID-19, they oftentimes fell under the critical or the severe illnesses that was oftentimes associated with COVID-19. And unfortunately, they were our largest statistic for mortality.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think I did want to hear from you about the impact on the Native American community, because I think the impact on Native American communities around the country has been quite high. So let me actually, with both Sherlita and with Patty, come to you sort of on both of those questions. You know, first, were there issues for either of you in Westchester or Rockland dealing with sort of this balancing act between religious groups that were sort of claiming, in effect, exemption from local public health laws? And then second, and we can sort of come back to you again on this, Kevin, but the whole question of the, you know, the extraordinarily significant and adverse impact that COVID has had on marginalized communities, Native American communities of color, low income, et cetera, et cetera. But maybe first let's start with the religious versus public health issue. Has that been an issue for either of you in around COVID-19? Patty, do you want to start in Rockland?
Sure. So we had, in dealing with the measles outbreak, going back to that, we had developed, I want to say, good communication with our religious community. Having said that, there are a number of sects that are part of the community. So it's difficult to have one liaison, for example, you know, that we would be able to speak with and that who could speak for the entire group. And that was a problem then, and it's still a problem now. We have many, many of the people in our religious community who abide by what is needed to be done. But there are always, you know, some in any community that you see, but who do not abide. And that is a problem within the community, within the, all of Rockland, in the entire Rockland community, as I want to call it, because there are people who then look to them, you know, in a negative way as a result of that. And so, you know, for them, many are saying, you know, this is God's will. This is, if it happens, this is what we, you know, we can't help. It's what God wants. And of course, we try to continue our educational efforts and our, you know, communication with the leaders of the community. County Executive's office has also been working on that from their aspects of it, to meeting with the mayors of the different villages and attempting to work with them. But it's a continuous challenge, let me say.
So with the assistance of our County Executive's office, we did open communication with the religious communities, primarily in New Rochelle, because that's where our original cases were. And I think we had great success. There was several meetings with leadership, and we just had really good cooperation, I think, from the very beginning. There were no major issues that I can think of, and I think it went quite well, actually.
No, that's great, because again, I recall just seeing, for example, in the newspapers, you know, some situations, and particularly I think in Brooklyn, you know, where there were incidents that became quite controversial. What about the issue of for all three of you, of the sort of impact on, you know, the sort of excessively significant impact on sort of marginalized communities, on minority communities, on low-income communities? I mean, as a public health leader, what's your role in sort of helping to respond in particular to certain vulnerable populations, you know, where they're, you know, low-income workers who are sort of the essential healthcare workers. So they're going to be out the ones out there, you know, delivering food to people, or delivering equipment, or driving, you know, the cars. And then of course, as you said, Kevin, many in those communities have significant underlying health conditions to begin with. So where sort of in sort of the response that you all three of you had to provide, how did you think about and how did you deal with sort of the disproportionate impact on low-income marginalized communities?
I think this is where our Department of Social Services really kind of stepped up to the plate, and also our Office of Mental Health, because we also had individuals with underlying mental health conditions that for them the isolation was an extreme problem. And creating wraparound services so that people who were out of work could get food from food banks and other sources. I think that it just having that support and having them out there, because it's a role that I can't fill as the health department. So certainly having the rest of my colleagues in the county step up to the plate and take that off of my plate was very, very helpful to me. And I think that we've had some, you know, a great deal of success. I'm sure that there's things that, you know, maybe we would have liked to have went a little smoother, but overall, I think it went better than I imagined it would.
Likewise, we had worked with other departments, Office of the Aging, DSS, the Office of Mental Health, as well as our own staff who have gone out into the communities. We have employees who speak Creole, who speak Spanish, who speak Yiddish, and they have gone out to the communities to work with them more directly. We were able to get testing opportunities for them, not just a drive-in testing, which had been placed by the state initially, but a walk-in testing center in our village of Havistraw, for example. And that was, I think, provided a lot of assistance to those who didn't have cars and couldn't get there, but were able then to be tested.
Kevin, you've got, obviously, in addition to the Seneca Nation, in rural areas, there's, I'm sure, significant rural poverty in parts of your county. Dealing with low-income and marginalized populations in a rural county like yours, how has that played out?
Well, it's all about the messaging that you provide for your community. Oftentimes, you really have to bring in the leadership of those individuals who really can make an impact on that population. Oftentimes, you know, we may talk in public health lingo, and it just overrides a significant portion of your community. But when you can engage leadership of those in your community who are really involved with that population, those who are in poverty, those who might be of color in your community, it really has a significant impact in relaying the message that you're trying to get out there, that it is important for you, although you are out there as an essential worker, to protect yourself and protect your family. And you do that by wearing masks if necessary, not being in social gatherings, and of course, making sure that you, you know, wash your hands as frequently as possible for this particular virus. This virus had a significant impact on the community of color, you know, and I'm sure everyone knows about it, but just in New York City itself, I believe it was somewhere around 62% of the community of color that really lost their lives through COVID-19. And we, you know, when we go back and do a study, do this and review what has happened, we're going to probably learn that it could have been, we could have did better messaging for this community in order to prevent a number of lives lost that we saw in this community.
Yeah. No, I think that's really true. The communication, you mentioned communication, and let me ask you about that. I mean, I think there was communication, and there has been communication from a variety of levels. Obviously, the president for a while had his task force and was having his daily press conferences talking about the crisis, which have ended, you know, as of a few weeks ago. The governor here in New York, sometimes I think primarily by himself, but oftentimes with Commissioner Zucker with him, was having his sort of daily press conferences and sort of updates on what was happening here in New York. To what extent, you know, you mentioned your role, each of the three of you has mentioned the importance of communication and getting out there and talking to community leaders. I mean, how much of your time and has been sort of engaged in sort of this communication effort? And to what extent is that still sort of a key part of your role today? You know, as we're beginning to segue and move into this, at least here in New York, we'll talk about Florida, Arizona, and Texas in a couple of minutes and the rest of the country. But at least here in New York, as we move into the phase twos, phase threes, phase fours, and things start to open up, talk a little about how you communicate within your own communities, the need to still be vigilant and the need to not be complacent as your communities begin to open up? You want to start?
So I could say that really the communication issue first came to fore with the schools, and we were being barraged with calls from superintendents, principals, teachers, parents, students, in regards to, you know, is my school safe? Is my child safe? When can they go back to school? Parents with special needs children saying, you know, the virtual classrooms are not working for my student, for my child. And so having as much communication as possible with that group early on, I think helped a lot until schools were actually closed. And then, of course, that communication was no longer necessary.
What's going to happen in the fall? I'm sure you're
getting those. We're already getting those calls. But I can tell you, my cell phone, I think there's probably very few people in Westchester County that don't actually have my cell phone number. And if they are, you know, I'd be surprised. But being able to, for people to just reach out to you when they needed to, has been very important, I think, for municipal leaders, certainly the hospitals, schools, just people in general, and tons of email. I answer all the emails that I get, and I answer all the phone calls I get. And so you can do broad-based communication where you're speaking, you know, you're out in front of the public, but there's also the back end of communication, which is the one-on-one with people, and really people who are in leadership roles. I think having those communications directly with them, that they can then translate that for the people who work for them or the people that they engage with, is very important. So I've tried to make myself as open as possible to as many people as possible, and as have my staff, so that we can be reassuring to them. I think our biggest concern, though, is complacency, because we've done a good job, but it's hard to keep people at home forever. And so now, you know, the whole world is wanting to break loose. They want to go back to normal. And we're not ready for everyone to go back to normal. So now communication is even more important, I think, than has been up to now. And so getting the right messaging out is something we're still going to have to work on. And we're not done yet.
Yeah, no, I think you're exactly right about the messaging in this stage. I mean, it's one thing to simply say, everybody stay home, or, you know, but it becomes a much more complicated message when you say, okay, you can begin to go out, but, you know, but A, but B, and but C. Patty, thoughts on communication?
So as far as availability, we have made ourselves available through a calling center that we set up here in the health department. And of course, we've still received, you know, other calls as well, more directly. Been glad to answer them all along. You know, we utilize social media. We've had a number of press releases, which invites then the press to ask more questions and have some press events. There hasn't been as many lately because it hasn't been really anything brand new to say. Though having said that, it's a reminder to all of us, even with what Sherlita mentioned, that this is the time in this newer phase of what we need to provide as far as information to everyone, because they just want to break loose and do what they need to do. And we have to remind them of the back to, you know, basic public health, as Kevin mentioned, washing the hands, social distancing, and the importance that we know now of wearing masks. And people, I think, are tired of hearing it. I'm trying to think of innovative ways to get the message across. We're also meeting, you know, with virtually, you know, with students, with the collaboratives to try to stay active with them, but still looking for innovation to be able to provide our message and not have people bored of hearing it from us, though it's as important as ever, if not more so.
No, and it's really complicated. And the messaging piece, Kevin, I'm sort of thinking about your comment about at times you had to send the sheriff out, you know, whether it was with this group or with that group. And I know one of the things, there was an article in the New York Times a couple of days ago, and I'm not sure if you saw it or if you're familiar with this issue, but the article reported, and it didn't interview people here in New York State, but it reported that in a number of communities around the country, health department leaders, health department officials were getting sort of verbal abuse, sometimes death threats, you know, pushback in ways that they'd never gotten previously or rarely got previously, because they were now much more visible, and they were much more visible communicating a message that at times people didn't want to hear. Has that been, I mean, I'll start with you, Kevin, on this, but then open it up. In terms of the resistance, you know, and I don't know if maybe this is more of an issue in other states and won't be as big an issue here in New York, but have you, Kevin, or Sherlita or Patty, have you felt sort of, or your staff, you know, the staff that are out doing contact tracing, when they call people, you know, when they're dealing with people, I mean, what kind of response are they getting? And are people feeling abused at times, public health workers feeling sort of picked on or abused or threatened? I mean, how is that playing out?
Well, I think it's, you know, I think initially when this first came down, the first 2 or 3 months, everyone was okay with hunkering down in their homes and abiding by the guidelines that we were issuing for them, especially for those who were non-essential workers, to stay off the streets if you could, because we had no other arsenal in order to treat this virus. There were no antiviral medication. There's no vaccine to treat it. And the only way we knew in order to reduce the spread of this vaccine is to basically have folks to isolate within their homes. And so my community was okay with that initially. But after that, after we moved into phase 2 and 3, excuse me, we started to see that the community became a little bit more restless. They had cabin fever, so to speak, and they really wanted to get out. So when they first came out, you can see everyone wearing masks. They were abiding by social distancing, but then it became a different issue. Things, you know, theories of, well, you have a low prevalence of the virus in our community, so it's really not that widespread that that you are talking about. So I'm not going to wear a mask. I'm going to go to the store, and I'm going to brave this thing out. And so we're seeing some resistance now, but initially we did not see that resistance. So you see folks who are still trying to comply with some of those guidelines, but yet there are others who are being a little bit more resistant as time starts to creep by now.
Right. I mean, I do think, you know, that you do read stories, I mean, of sort of occasional battles between store owners telling people to put masks on and people not wanting to do it, or, you know, private citizens saying yay or nay to a mask or social distancing. What about your workers? Have your workers, you know, how, as the contact tracing has started up again right now, have the workers been sort of, you know, what sort of reception have the workers gotten as they've sort of really tried to deal with people on these issues on an individual basis?
Well, my workers haven't had any problems with anyone actually being resistant to giving them information when they are doing the contact tracing. Occasionally, you may get one or two individuals who have been asked to quarantine or isolate in their homes, being reported by neighbors who have seen them outside, maybe walking their dogs or something, and they'll call them in to the health department. But a call from the health department to tell them that, you know, you have signed this order that requires you to stay within your quarters, and you need to make sure that that happens, they tend to start to, they will abide by that. We also had our sheriff deputies on occasions to stop by each one of those homes that were under isolation and or quarantine and just drive by at night just to make sure that they were abiding by that. So we work together, as Dr. Amler say, in a wraparound group here. Our EOC was able to involve all of our county health departments in this COVID-19 response. And it really did help in our community response.
So we're looking at the clock. I can't believe we only have about 5 minutes left. And I have, I guess, two more questions. Sherlita, let me start with you. When you look at Texas and the numbers, the surge in Texas and Arizona and Florida these days, and you think back to your own experience as a leader in Westchester dealing with the crisis that you dealt with, tell me your thoughts and tell me, you know, your concerns and if you worry about sort of ripple back here in New York. I mean, just when you read the newspapers about what's going on right now, what are the reactions do you have?
Well, I think, you know, back in March when we had the first case identified, the issue was that it wasn't the first case. There were cases. Once we knew there was a case, we became aware of a lot more cases, even though we've been looking. So I think it's staying vigilant. And that's why it's so important that now that we have contact tracers, large groups of contact tracers. So when we identify cases, we're really being very aggressive in getting a hold of that person, telling them they're positive, putting them on isolation, asking about their contacts, notifying those contacts and putting them in quarantine. We have to stay ahead of the disease. And I think that's the thing that I've learned most about this, is that we have to be one step ahead instead of one step behind. And that's what we're trying to do.
Patty, what's it been like to be a leader in the midst of all this? I mean, you've got a lot of leadership experience. Has this been different? I mean, obviously you talked about the measles crisis a couple of years ago. I mean, but has this felt different, and what's it been like to sort of lead your organization through this crisis?
So we thought that the measles outbreak was the be all end all, and it was probably not even practice for what we're doing here. So it's been a challenge. It's a continuous challenge. But I think the important part is that we rise to the challenge. We accept what we can do. We ask our staff to do more and more all the time, especially since our numbers are more limited than years past. And they have risen to the challenge of doing that. And with challenges come opportunities, a lot of education that's needed. And as Shirley has said, we have to stay ahead as best we can. We've had some experience now with this. A couple of months ago, we had zero experience. So now we've had, 5-6 months of experience. And hopefully then with the fall coming, we'll do additional education. We'll continue our efforts all summer. The flu season is coming once again, and that'll be a very important time to continually educate for a flu vaccine and the importance of that this year, even more probably important than many other years. And hopefully we can stay ahead of everything that's coming, toward us.
So I'm going to ask a question. I was being interviewed yesterday by someone else in a completely different context. And the person ended the interview by asking me a few questions, which I had really could not give an educated answer to at all on any of the questions. But now that I have three local public health commissioners, I'm gonna at least get your speculation. And so the first question I'm gonna ask you is, when do you think you will feel comfortable again shaking somebody's hand? And when do you think you're going to feel comfortable sitting in a movie theater or going to a ball game? I mean, as you, your own crystal ball, as you look ahead, here in Westchester and Rockland and Cattaraugus County, I mean, when do you think, and that's, do you have some thoughts on that? Any one of those?
When I've had a sustained period of time with no disease, I'll feel comfortable. But right now, I don't, I have to say.
Well, when there's a vaccine, I think I'll be ready and more comfortable to start to sit in the movie theater and shake hands.
I like that idea too.
I'm looking for treatments that work as well as a vaccine. So I think we're a way off for shaking hands, Michael, at this point.
It'll be a while before we shake hands or before we go to another Nick game or something like that, it sounds
right.
But if I could say one thing, I would say that what we have in New York as a commissioner, you talked about, what's happened across the country. In New York, the commissioners of health and the directors of health, we are a tight-knit group and we depend on each other and we have each other. And that has helped sustain us all through this. And I can't tell you what a great group of people I have that I work with. The other commissioners in the state, I mean, they all make my job, I think, doable.
Well, and I hope that we here at the Mailman School are going to graduate some students that are going to end up going to work with all of you and help to provide some of the resources that you need going forward. Before we close out today, I just want to remind everybody watching that our next event, our next panel, will be on July 9th. And on July 9th, we're going to have three state officials present. We will have Howard Zucker, the Commissioner of Health here in New York. We will have Sue Birch from Washington State to talk about the experience in Seattle and Washington State. and we will have Jennifer Sullivan from the Institute of Indiana. So I ask you to all put that on your calendar. But most of all, I want to thank Kevin and Patty and Sherlita. This has been, the hour has gone by very fast. It's been quite interesting, quite informative, quite educational, and just a terrific opportunity for me to have a chance to interact and talk to each of you. So good luck with all the amazing work that you do. I mean, I really want to just say on behalf of someone in a school of public health, how grateful I am and how grateful we are for the leadership that you show and that you continue to show as we deal with this crisis. And I hope that you stay safe yourself and continue to lead in such an exemplary way. So thanks everybody. And until we the next time, that'll be it for today. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye now.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.